Hi, I'm Ellie Honig. I'm a CNN senior legal analyst, and I'm here today to analyze some of your favorite courtroom dramas. As a lawyer, I spent 14 years as a federal and state prosecutor. I tried all sorts of criminal cases like the ones we see in some of these movies, and now I am a CNN senior legal analyst. It's fascinating to go behind the scenes of a jury deliberation like this, but a couple things you would never see in real life.
The gentleman has a right to see exhibits and evidence.
Say, could you bring us the knife?
Knife?
Yeah. Thank you.
Number one, there are no weapons in the jury room. Sometimes juries do want to see weapons, knives, or guns. What'll happen in that case is the judge will have the jury come back out into the courtroom and very carefully hand it to them one by one. Also, you cannot use a piece of evidence like the other knife that the juror bought on his own. So here, when Henry Fonda takes out the knife that he bought, that would be completely improper. If they wanted to see the actual knife from the trial, they could ask the judge to see it. But again, a courtroom marshal or somebody would very carefully hand it to the jurors. They'd never be left on their own with a weapon in the jury room.
You mean you're asking us to believe that somebody else did the stabbing with exactly the same kind of knife?
The odds are 1,000,001.
It's possible.
These jurors, when they talk about what's possible or probable, 1,000,001, that's a classic conversation and dispute that lawyers have and juries have, beyond a reasonable doubt. We all know that's the standard of liability in a criminal case, but what exactly does that mean? The answer is there's no mathematical formula for it. It's really up to each individual jury as we see play out in this movie. As great a dramatic vehicle as it is to have a husband and wife arguing a case against one another, this would almost certainly never happen in real life because of what we call a conflict of interest. The defendant in a case gets his or her choice of counsel. And if that ended up being the wife in a couple, as in this case, the prosecutor's office would then never assign the husband to prosecute that case.
Do you wish to see justice done in this case?
Yes.
All right then, tell the truth.
Katharine Hepburn is a master of cross-examination here. I know she's not an attorney, I know she's an actress, but the way she does this cross-examination ought to be taught in law schools. The way she moves around the courtroom, the way she asks very specific, direct follow-up questions, and the way she very subtly but effectively plays to the jury. At one point when the prosecutor objects to her question,
objection, leave.
If you watch, Katharine Hepburn shoots a very quick sort of eye roll into the jury as if to say sort of, you believe this guy keeps interrupting me? That's something you learn to do after many, many trials, and she does it marvelously here, really effectively. You can see why she was such a wonderful actress. There's an interesting moment at the end of this direct examination where Katharine Hepburn seems to make an on-the-spot decision to end the direct examination. The witness is crying and Katharine Hepburn starts to approach, and then you can see she thinks twice about it and says, that's it, I'm done. That's a really smart move that prosecutors and defense lawyers sometimes have to make on the spot. Where's a good spot to end this? And you can see her very quickly going through that sort of mental process and coming out with what I think is the right decision.
In this country, our courts are the great levelers. In our courts, all men are created equal.
This scene just gives me chills. It is a masterpiece. It's a masterpiece of filmmaking. It is probably the most perfect example of what a closing argument could be and should be that I've ever seen. The way that Gregory Peck delivers this with passion and emotion, but he's not over the top, he's not screaming, and he's making a real substantive argument here. At the same time, he's decrying racism, he's also explaining why his client was falsely accused in this case. And the crescendo of this closing argument is one of the most touching, remarkable scenes I've ever seen. When Gregory Peck leans forward and he says, without passion, and he says, the courts are the great leveler. And then he ends it with,
in the name of God, do your duty.
I now realize that I've seen a lot of defense lawyers doing very, very bad impressions of Gregory Peck in this movie, but the scene is remarkable. I've never seen anything really so moving to an attorney as this closing argument. Atticus Finch is so revered as an attorney for a couple reasons. First of all, he takes on a difficult case. He takes on an underdog of a case. He represents a wrongly accused black man in what appears to be a southern town in front of an all-white male jury. And he defends that person passionately and zealously and effectively. And I think he also shows an appreciation for the power of the courts and the jury system, that, as he says in this closing argument, the courts are the great equaler. Now, he doesn't even win, so to speak, in this case. Of course, Tom Robinson is convicted, but still, he stands up for the right thing. He defends the defenseless. And I think that's why the Atticus Finch character, particularly as portrayed here by Gregory Peck, is so powerful and resonant.
Rachel Brown, come to stand.
Did you know about this?
This could never happen in a real criminal trial. The defense gets caught by surprise here by the prosecution's surprise witness. But in reality, prosecutors have to tell the defense well in advance who their witnesses will be. You have to file a witness list with the court. You have to even turn over any statements that the witness has made. So this kind of gotcha moment where a prosecutor calls an unexpected witness and catches the defense off guard, that would never happen in a real courtroom. Frederick Marsh is, of course, quite over the top in this movie. It's theatrical, it's dramatic. He's screaming in the face of witnesses. He's sweating, he's screaming, he's ranting and raving. All that said, some of what lawyers do is meant to be theatrical, and I've never seen a lawyer go quite as far as Frederick Marsh does in this movie, but I've seen lawyers get 80%, 85% of the way there. They can work themselves up into quite a righteous lather. So Frederick Marsh is an exaggerated version of that, but I've seen variations of it not quite as dramatic and extreme as this.
Do as I say you got to.
I've got to what? Send you to jail?
Let her go.
There's a really interesting moment here where Spencer Tracy, who's the defense lawyer, is talking with his client, played by Dick York. The client wants the defense lawyer not to ask any questions on cross-examination. He just wants the lawyer to let the witness go without further damage. The lawyer is begging his client.
Don't tie my hands, son.
In reality, it is the decision of the client. It is the decision of the defendant. And you'll hear lawyers sometimes say, all I can do is advise my client. I can't make my client do anything, whether I think it's the right move or not. So this scene is really quite accurate. I think movies like these do push a lot of people towards a career in the law. You see these movies, of course they're dramatized, of course they're not exactly how things would play out in a real life court of law, but a lot of the principles and the ideas that you see in these movies really animate people and motivate people to go to law school and to become lawyers. I know that movies like these four had a big impact on my career decisions, and that's why they're classics. They sort of live forever and they resonate with people through generations.